pleasure to introduce the next speaker, Professor Goswami. Professor Goswami finished his PhD from Princeton in 1994. Then he was a postdoctoral at Harvard and Brookhaven National Lab. After that, he returned to India and he was a faculty member at TIFR for about 5 years. And since then, he has moved to IIT Kanpur in Department of Chemistry. He has published several research papers and also a book on nanocomputing published by McGraw-Hill. He's a Wellcome Trust senior research fellow and he's also collaborating with Dialbagh Institute on this new program in quantum information.
It's a pleasure to be back at Dialbagh. This is better. And especially honored to be in the session which is being chaired by none other than my hero Narendra Karmarkar. Quantum computing or anything to do with computing actually whatever enthused me was sort of, I would say, began by the ideas of two main people who influenced me in this area. One was who is the chair of this session, and the other one was Ramani, who was the head of the NCST, National Center for Software Center in Bombay. So when I was in TIFR doing physics, I got into that area, and since then I have been exploring areas of quantum computing. And to me, it is an area where we can ask questions which yet has no answers in a perfect sense. And as an experimentalist, it's a wonderful situation because we are confronting frontiers where perhaps solutions are not yet known. And so I often get the good feeling that we are working on problems which hopefully has a solution. Some of the slides that I have put are mostly for the help of the students, which unfortunately I think today you are having some exams or something. So I think the students are not in a plenty number today, but nevertheless we will see how things go. And most of the work is possible mostly because of students. One of my main reasons for which I moved from TIFR to IIT Kanpur was the students, because for an experimentalist you need a large body of students who work with you, and if you don't have the large body of students, then it becomes very, very ineffective to come up and do any research. And TIFR, otherwise being a wonderful institution, one of the biggest problem it used to have is the number of students. Fortunately, with the new campus in Hyderabad coming up, I am hoping that, you know, the future generation of TIFR faculty members will not have the problem that I face. Also, space was a major concern. Without any further introduction, let me get into this problem that we are going to talk about. Until now, you have been hearing and listening lots of talks on the mathematical aspects of the problem. Today I have decided, this is perhaps my fourth talk in Dialbagh on the area of quantum computing in the years, and so today, instead of going into more of introduction and more of mathematical issues, I have decided to focus on what I am essentially known for, or what I essentially work on, which are experiments. And so I begin with the concept which is the experimentalist realism, or the dilemma that we face when we confront the problem of quantum computing. So the first problem is, when we are in this area, we have to first look for appropriate and accessible quantum systems. That is the first issue that we have to worry. Secondly, when and whenever we get to that point, the very next thing which we have to really worry about is how to modulate the quantum system, not only temporally, which is very important to be done within the coherence times, which is required for logic operations, but also spatially. And this is the part which I will explain to you today, as which is required for scaling quantum computer. And since spatial and temporal control both are required, we will be needing experimental handles or knobs, as we call it, to get into something which is known as spatio-temporal control. So, unless you have this concept of spatio-temporal control, you will not be able to be in a position to scale up your concepts of mathematics that we are talking about, of the issues which work very well on mathematical grounds, on writing of matrices, into a realistic system. And in order to make a realistic system where you can scale, it is very important that we also have a spatial control, because it is very nice to make a quantum computer on a single molecule which will execute the logic gate for you, but unless you are able to tell that the next logic operation has to happen in the next and the passing on information has to happen, that becomes a major issue. So, the spatial control is one of the aspects which was sort of a miss, which I think, once again, I think Karmarkar had a hunt for it and sort of mentioned it in passing in one of the talks that he had given, where he sort of indicated that spatial control is one of the most important aspects if you would like to scale up quantum computing. So, based on these concepts, as an experimentalist, I got the wind on the sail, let us put it that way, to try out these areas of spatio-temporal control, which in itself is quite a challenge as an experimentalist. Now, just to qualify, knobs are the experimental control parameters, and they need not always be the control parameters necessary for quantum objects. One of the ways to look at quantum mechanics is to say that you are going to look at wave properties, and whenever you have wave properties, the control knobs have to worry about interference principles. So, that is why you write your density matrices, and that is why you propagate the things, and in computer science it's much easier to actually do these problems by using linear algebra. But when you are confronting experimentally the problem, you can have two different kinds of control knobs. One which is going to look at it from an angle of interference principle. So, this is going to really have the control quantum effect, but there has to be other kind of control knobs which is not just going to have an interference effect, but something which can also change the efficiency or can change the way things are happening, so that you basically turn down the system, turn up the system, those kinds of things. And one of the things which you need about these knobs to be very carefully happening to you or giving the control about to you is the fact that you are on the quest looking for knobs which are uncorrelated, which can be independently controlled. That's even harder. Why is it necessary? Because you can think, simply imagine the concept of having a radio with just one single knob which simultaneously changes the channel as well as changes the volume. You are in a mess. You can't really go to certain channels at all because you won't hear any volume out there. So, it is important to have two knobs which are independent of each other. So, that is the reason why you are looking for these kinds of problems where you have to control these issues. Now, in order to do that, as was mentioned here, I think that the best way to finally achieve quantum computer is to go to solid state devices, because that is the most convenient system. However, when you start off, if you look at it theoretically, the most convenient system is the system where the objects are maximally separated. So, that is why gas phase is perhaps the best first system to try out experimentally, to see certain aspects of the control that you are trying works out better. So, experimentally we have first tried out problems in the gas phase. That is the first problem. We have eventually gone to liquids as well as solids, but we will start off the story with the principle of gas phase, and we are looking at a specific problem of fragmenting a system. Now, in this case it is a big molecule, It's some kind of an alcohol, N-propyl alcohol, I think it's called. Yeah, so I'm pretty bad with chemistry, although I belong to the chemistry department. But anyway, right now I do belong to a chemistry department. But anyway, whatever it is an alcohol where we are looking at the photofragmentation process of the problem. So light here acts as my trigger process, and we are going to see if we can control this process by using this. So typically in chemistry, trust me, this was made by my students, so they know much better chemistry than I do. In chemistry, conventional methods of control are based on issues like temperature, pressure, concentration and things like that. And so these are the typical schemes. What we have done is we have actually used light, because laser is a light process, and light turns out to be a better process, because if you can use light as one of the ways to control, then the parameter is one of the things which will be much easier in your hand. So there are different ways of using light to control your fragmentation. It can be simply as a matter of a hammer. So the intensity of the light can itself be one of the control parameters, but that is not a control at the level of the quantum level. It is a control where, as I said, it's just a sound volume control. You can just increase the intensity higher and lower, and at certain points it's an audible situation, or at certain points the situation is not even audible. That means the system essentially is going to happen or not happen. So this is just an off-on situation. However, a much better control, which is like having to tune your frequency to the one channel that you want to listen to, is a much better control. And in that respect, you would like to change the property of the laser pulse as to how that is, and see whether you can do a control on the fragmentation process. And we found out that the simplest process is to change the way the pulse character is. It's sort of like something where the frequency of the light is changing continuously within the time on which the light is on. Now let me just give you a point also, that these laser pulses that we are talking about are going to be at time scales where we have no problem of decoherence, in the sense that these have to be much, much faster than any vibrational time scale of the molecule. And so it has to be at time scales which are known as femtoseconds, which is 10 to the power minus 15, several 10 to the power minus 15 orders, because that is the time scales in which the molecule, any molecular system, will have a vibrational time period. So in order to get a generalized system where you are going to have pulses of light which can influence the procedure of the system, has to be in those time scales. So that is why people use several femtosecond time scales to do this. Today technology allows you to go even shorter in time, and those are known as ottoseconds, 10 to the power minus 18, and in those time scales it is in fact even possible to freeze the electronic motion. And these are also important, and these are important because those of you who have seen old chemistry textbooks and you remember a little bit of it, you might be remembering those pi orbitals, s orbitals, they show all these hazes going in. They were all just pictures or theories just like that. Today you can in fact take a pictogram of that. You can freeze frame the electrons and take a picture, because you have reached those time scales, right? That is what it is. So in order to, so the time scales are very important. That's why in these time scales where I want to basically do the fragmentation process in such a way so that it is much, much faster than any coherent other processes coming into the picture, it has to be in the time scales which are in femtoseconds. So we take those time scales and we change the property of the light within that time scale. So we can, again, we cannot do this in real time, because there are no modulators possible in those time scales. So we have to go into a Fourier domain, and we do this in the Fourier domain. Light is very nice in that way. You can use Fourier optics, and all of us know that we almost in everyday phenomena we are often using Fourier optics when you are using glasses to see me. Glasses are fantastic Fourier plane objects. You can use simple glasses to convert, I mean lenses, which are your glasses that you are using. These are perfect ways of looking at Fourier transforms. So physical Fourier transforms are very simple to do. So by using physical Fourier transforms, you can get into a way how to do your change the property of the light and do it that way. As we go along, I don't know if anybody has discussed Shor's algorithm here or not. Those of you who have seen it, you would also know that it's actually the quantum Fourier transform principle, which is used in Shor's algorithm. And so, if you look at it, the concept of using light has its advantages. We'll get into those details later. But the principle here is that we basically can change the way the light frequency is, and once we do that, we are able to specifically that these are quantifications of how you define how much it is going to change and all that. These are experimental details. But what we find is that we can control the way these fragmentation processes occur, and the fragments which come out can be experimentally measured. Okay. Although it might sound so simple and easy, the system which is used is quite complicated. This is a molecular beam chamber where the experiment is done in one of the chambers like this. This is a stainless steel chamber, and the way you make these chambers have all these molecules come in a specific particular way is to use huge pumps, so that you reduce, you essentially remove everything else but these molecules that you want to inject. And in order to do those, today we use turbo pumps, which if you see would be, these are basically the propellers that you see in your aeroplanes. Okay, these are the propellers. They rotate so fast that they can take out all the air, suck out all the air, and you can go down to 10 to the power minus 8 atmospheres of pressure. Under that condition, you can just inject molecules from one of the ends, and you can select a few of those molecules in such a way so that they are under laminar conditions. So under those laminar flow conditions, you will be having molecules coming with a very nice flow, and under those flow parameters you can go into definitions like Mach number and all those. We don't need to do that, but generally the basic idea is you are actually seeing molecules coming in very nicely ordered way. Under that condition, when you cross them with a laser, you can specifically pick out a single molecule and study that molecule's fragmentation process, and that is the reason why it is so easy or to explain the physical phenomena which happens as a result of that. And these are the results that you can see, that you will be having different kinds of fragmentations which come out based on the molecular system, and depending on how you change the property of the laser pulse, you can see them have different features. Okay. So let me just go directly. So this is the part which is interesting. You have, when you have no, the pulse is just like what you would expect a transform limited condition. That means there is, we have not played around with the property of the pulse. It has certain distribution, but when we change the property of the pulse, frequency going one way versus frequency going the other way, the distribution changes very specifically. So this is how you get control over certain fragments. Now these are the fragments, since they are having different masses, they will be isolated, separated by mass spectrometry. So this is possible to do it at this level. Once we do this, we have one control parameter here. So what I have established under these conditions is that experimentally I have one parameter here which actually controls how the fragmentation process is going to happen, and it changes the distribution of the ions. Now the next parameter I want to look for is called polarization. Okay. Now what is polarization? Again, polarization has been mentioned here. Now we are talking about light polarization here. In this case, the light polarization is the direction in which our electric field is oscillating. If it is linearly oscillating, then it oscillates either vertically or horizontally. That is one of the ways. And if it is circularly polarized, then you will have the horizontal and the vertical coming right after each other in 90 degrees apart, so that it looks like a screw going in. Okay, that's the circularly polarized light. At any point of time, if you take a projection, it will look like a circle. You take any screw, you will see it like that. That's how the circularly polarization is going, either going forward or going backward. So that is the circularly polarized light and the linearly polarized light. By the way, if you want to take, if you want to treat light as a quantum object, when you take its projection, projection is nothing but taking the measurement along one axis, the fundamental property of light, by the way, is the circularly polarized light. This is the light which has the plus one, minus one, the quantum numbers. The linear polarized light is in fact a linear combination of the two circularly polarized light. Okay. Often it is thought about in the other way, that you have which is more fundamental, because linear polarized light is something which you often get, but generally circularly polarized light is the more fundamental quantum property, which if you have a measurement you will get an eigenvalue, whereas if you actually measure linearly polarized light in terms of measurement, you will not get the eigenvalue, it is a combination, it is a superposition result. So that is one of the things which is to be also noted. So here, however, we are not doing a single quantum system, we are not treating light as quantum. Here we are treating light as a classical situation, where we are having a screw kind of a situation, which is light going vertically or horizontally, and between the two we find that there is a control. One of them does enhances, and it goes through these kinds of peaks. These are all, again, these are all the fragments. Now, one of the things you have to notice here, this time I am not dispersing the fragmentation properties. All the fragments are there, they are just going all together, going up and going down. It is like a volume property here, right? Because I have treated it semi-classically, now the light parameter acts like a volume property. It is actually going, just taking all the fragments up or all the fragments down. It is not actually dispersing the fragments in their own control way, as you have done it with your frequency parameter. Because in the frequency parameter, you had actually taken a single laser pulse and you had changed the property of the laser pulse within that. But still, remember, in both the cases, they are actually not at the quantum level, because I am not taking a single photon of light in both the cases. These are many, many photons of light coming. And yet, in one case, I managed to pick the single property of the system, whereas quantum level property of the system, whereas in the other case I am actually picking it up on a different scale. So these are two different knobs, but they are knobs in a different way, and since they are working in these two different ways, they happen to be completely mutually exclusive of each other. So when I have a polarization going this way versus the frequency content of a laser pulse going the other way, then they are completely mutually exclusive. I can completely work on my polarization independent of my chirp parameter, which is the property of the laser frequency within the laser, within the pulse, and I can have them independently working on each other. So this was actually an interesting result, because it turns out that of all the quest of looking for knobs, it is not yet possible to look for knobs which are completely mutually exclusive. Almost all the knobs are connected in one way or the other to each other. Okay, and since both these knobs, control knobs, are not specifically possible to be pointed out as a quantum knob to start with, one of them behaving quantum mechanically at the end and the other one essentially remaining as semi-classical at the end, to the end, picks out, gives out two different parameters. And so what happens is, at the end you can get polarization only case, polarization plus chirp case, where you are actually dispersing and then showing them differently and then going through that property. So you can make a play, a combination of these two now, and try to see if these fragments can act like your qubits. Point is, at the end of the day you are looking for qubits which is controllable at your hand, so that you can devise logic devices, logic problems for you. So this is one of the ways of looking at the problem. Now in gas phase, I already told you the advantage, that is that they are far enough away so that this So this is a wonderful model for single model, single molecule systems, or in fact ion traps essentially work on the same idea. The ions are trapped in such a way so that they are far enough away so that you can have all these properties having of each other. The difficulty again of the ion traps is how do you manipulate them to come closer or to have them intermittently connect to each other, and that's why you could only get about 8 to 10 qubits possible in an ion trap, because within that field which is magnetically coupled in that case, you can create a ripple which will make them couple only up to 8 or 9 qubits. If you want to go further than that, you can't do it because your field property doesn't allow you, and since they are physically separated, you have a problem. So this is one of the issues which you have to quantify, and that's why I told you in the beginning only that spatiotemporal control is one of the things which you need to have. So here we enter. So what is the, so this year we have not yet started, 2010 is the 50 years of lasers, and one of the forgotten persons in this laser field is now been finally recognized by the Optical Society of America also, is Ashkin, who had first developed the concept of optical tweezers. So the idea is, it's a very simple idea, and it actually doesn't involve anything very fancy. Even a optical light, I mean this pointer can be used in that case. All it relies on is a Gaussian profile of a laser beam, which due to its profile is going to apply photon flux enough such that it's going to hold the particle due to the field photon flux of the light. Turns out that the Gaussian profile is very, very important, because the profile of the Gaussian essentially provides exactly the gradient that is needed, necessary to bring the particle or keep the particle moving away because of the Brownian motion. Otherwise it's a Brownian, this was done in liquids, so it's a Brownian motion problem. So you have a Brownian motion of the particle in the liquid, which is now being controlled because of the photon flux of the light, which is the Gaussian light. Now if you actually take a flat top, this we purposefully did in our lab, we took a flat top Gaussian and it did not trap, because here it's a drastic change and it's not able to produce a gradient which can actually trap the molecule, trap the particle. So we have physically verified the Gaussian profiles are essential. So in the very basic theory of these optical tweezers, there are two different domains. One is the domain where your particle is large and your field is oscillating very fast. This is when your diameter is much, much larger than your wavelength, and this is known as the Mi scattering region. Names are not important, but sometimes they are told because it is associated with some scientists and we should show our respect to them. And the other area, other part, is the Rayleigh scattering region, where the diameter of the particle is smaller than the wavelength. The essential result is the same. You end up producing the same effect, that you can trap the molecule or the particle, but the mechanism into which how these work is different. And in practice, many of these cases are used where the diameter is actually close to the size of the, close to the wavelength. So this is roughly the way the picture is drawn, that there is this restoring force which is due to the light pressure, which is created because of the propagation of the light. The Gaussian beam is therefore very, very essential, because as the light is moving into this, so this is a large enough particle, so as the light goes in, that's the bending of the light which is helping you to do these things, and so you get a restoring force, and you can in fact use a very simple harmonic oscillator principle to prove that you can show how this principle works. So here it's actually, that's why you use a focal, there's a tight focusing lens which helps this process, so that the particle is always trapped right close to the focal point. So that is what is being used to do that, and you get a stable trap. In the other case also, what you will find is that it's the polarizability rather than the bending of the light, that was refractive index. So, but either way, the essential result is that you are able to hold the particle in the trap. Now, the equilibrium, okay, it doesn't matter, these are more details. Okay. Now, what we thought about is that if we want to bring in temporal nature to this entire problem, then we have to bring in a pulse laser light, not these kinds of lasers which are continuously coming, because I don't have any control on time in these cases. So what we did was, we went to these laser pulses which we use for controlling, because we, as I mentioned to you before only, if we want to do any kind of molecular level control, it has to be in the time scales which are in this 10 to the, several 10 to the power 15, minus 15 seconds. So when what we did was we used the same technique, and it turns out that it also does the same job. In fact, it gives us additional advantages. What is the additional advantage? The viewing of the problem becomes much, much easier, because femtosecond pulses, each of these pulses have so much of an intensity that it can induce a process which is known as two-photon fluorescence. Means it will end up lighting up a fluorophore which otherwise would not be showing itself up because of the intensity of the laser pulse that is present there. Okay, so femtosecond pulses are impulsive pulse region pulses which create enough which creates results which are otherwise not possible, because it is able to induce those kinds of processes. So you can actually use a coated fluorophore which will be simultaneously trapped under this domain, and you can observe it much more easily. That is one advantage. Secondly, it can also help us in ways where we have to achieve a lot of intensity. So for instance, if you go down in size, it turns out that the intensity of light that you need to trap the particle becomes larger, because the Brownian force, Brownian motion is faster. So since the force, since it is faster, the restoration needs to have also a much higher force. That means you need lot more intensity of the laser. Now as you increase your intensity of the laser, it turns out that it also imparts heat. So that is not going to help you, it's going to hurt you. So heat, you want to reduce the heat, thermal load. Secondly, you also want to actually reach an intensity level which is required to get to these kinds of trapping. A very nice situation is achieved when you have very, very short pulses, because your intensity, instantaneous intensity is very high. So you will be able to achieve the intensities that you need, and yet you will be in the region where you have not violated the heat principle to that limit. And we were able to use that principle. This is basically the setup, generally quite an elaborate situation where you are able to also image it. So it's almost like a microscope in some ways. And you can see the light going in and doing this. And here is the example of these cases. There are two ways to observe this. One is by looking at the backscattering of the light which is going to hit the particle, and you can see the backscattering of it. So you have a background there, and in these cases you can see the background also. So this is the place where the light is going, and when the particle comes you can start seeing it. Okay. Now when you are looking at the two photon fluorescence, you can as well look at the fluorescence only, and in that case you don't see any backscattering. So it actually becomes much more easier to see it. So with a pulse laser, this approach is possible, whereas this is not possible for the other continuous lasers. That's the typical trapping problem. So this is one thing which you have an advantage with. Secondly, the other advantage that you get is the fact that you can now go to smaller and smaller particle and still trap them. And in fact, this is an example of a 100 nanometer LaTeX bead, which is otherwise very, very difficult to trap with a continuous wave laser because of the intensities that are necessary to trap these kinds of particles. But in our particular case, we can easily do that. And what we have landed up in is in a very interesting situation where we can in fact get to a situation we have trapped one particle, and we have now, it has come to a point that my trap size is such that I can, physically you can think about a potential. So the one particle goes in, and after a while a second particle can go in. And since you can get two particles going in there, if you choose particles which are not going to aggregate, then those two particles are independent of each other. At some sweet other time it might just decide to come out. In fact, we have seen those kinds of graphs also, which I don't have it here. Maybe in the next slide I might have. No, not here, sorry. So, the, now that gives us another very interesting situation to study, which is if you have a trap where you have actually put in now nanoparticles coming one after the other, and we can now study how they interact when they are actually close enough in a potential where they are almost like a non-interacting. In classes we teach, most of the time we teach two non-interacting particles in a one-dimensional box or something. When we teach them, we often take these examples, but which never experimentally can be shown. This is perhaps an example where we can actually experimentally show these kinds of phenomena happening and things. So, okay. So, that's that. Now, since I was talking to you about experiments, I got enthused and put some more of those experimental issues here. I don't know how much of it will be appreciated by you, but let me just, since I have taken you up to certain level of experimentation, I will give it a try to explain some other kinds of experiments. And the whole story in our particular case of quantum computing also started off with another perspective, which perhaps is important to let you know. That is, many a times you ask the question, why quantum computer? Let me play devil's advocate at this point. If I am on the funding agency side, I will say, why should you have anything to do with a situation which might not even ever happen? Because we had predicted some years ago, and many people had predicted, I think it came from IBM and other places also, that in a while it will come to a point that your computing will require quantum mechanics, because you will be confronted by it by the size principle. But yet today we have brought down the sizes, still following the Moore's law, and we are not yet finding quantum mechanics hurting our calculations. Okay, you are still happy doing away computing with all these computers which are all classical. Now, if that is the question, then many times your funding agencies will not be very happy to plate out quite a big sum of money for kinds of things that we would like to do. Now, if that is the way it is, then we have to also show that quantum mechanics or quantum computing has something which is very important, which is the back action. And what is the back action? In fact, it's almost like asking, why is NASA supported when NASA doesn't give anything to you on your plate? Turns out NASA gave us the microwave oven. So, on a daily life, is it something that you would be gaining? Yeah, if you would be doing quantum computing. So, to look at it that way, it turns out that many processes or many developments which are happening in other areas of science have some kind of a connection to some of these developments that we want to do. Very recently there was a paper, it is still on the ASAP of Journal of Chemical Physics, which came out, which talks about looking at NMR signals from bovine mouse or something in such a way which is much better than any other NMR techniques which have been used before, by using a pulse sequence which was used for the 8-bit quantum computing which was done earlier. Now, this particular work essentially highlights how quantum computing can have a big impact on other areas of science. So, in that spirit, I thought I will bring you up to light on some of the other areas of experiments which we are doing, which really doesn't fit into the bill of saying quantum computing, but has some other implications. So, I would like to bring you to tune with biology or something to do with biology. All these light-based studies that we are doing has some impact. One of the things which we are interested is to develop microscopy, because it links very well to all these tweezer work and whatever we are doing. And what we have found is that we are now in a position to do control on a microscope. So this is just it has just come out one of these, JBO, Journal of Biomedical Optics, where we have shown that we can actually put two pulses of light through the sample and control how the image of this otherwise very packed up fluorophores would be, and how we can actually distinguish between different fluorophores which is otherwise not possible to be distinguished. So these kinds of work are possible because we are pursuing these kind of areas. So here is another cute little idea which I think was very interesting, which is that we have a continuous wave, a continuous confocal microscopy. What we do is we pick on, this is a commercial system, it's called confocal microscope. In the confocal microscope, what people do is that they pick the image from the focal point by using an optical iris. Basically, they are stopping all other fluorescence from off the focal points, and they are just collecting it from the focus by putting an iris. Now, when we use pulse lasers, because of the spatiotemporal Fourier relationship, it only lasts over a very short period in space also, and they are separated out. Okay, they are separated out because they are like, they have a repetition rate. So some, like, you know, 80 megahertz or so, whatever megahertz you have, 76 megahertz, they are separated out. They are separated over 13 microseconds, and 13 microseconds, if you look at it, is some meter, right? Now you have one pulse which is only a micron or so, and then some meters away you have another pulse. So you are not going to have any effect of that other pulse. You can just take an image because of this only single pulse, which is spatially only present for about a micron, and then you can happily see the other fellow. You don't need any apertures or any very fancy way of trying to cut out any other fluorescence which appears from non-focal plane areas. So this is one of the other things that we have actually developed, which we have shown that you can do the same kind of a confocal microscopy by using single photons. So these are kind of developments that we have done, and in fact this is actually this is real stuff. This is a false staining though, but this is some dye which is used to stain the eye of a Drosophila, which is essentially a fly, fruit fly, small fruit fly, and you can section it. You can actually see the different sections as you just delay the pulse which is coming. So you just snapshot the different points of the pulse coming, and you can take a snapshot of how you look at it across the of the eye, which is actually an important parameter in microscopy. this is the work that was talking about, that you can actually coherently control two photon fluorescence, and the challenge in microscopy is different compared to what I have been showing you until now by doing those photofragmentation and other problems, because here you have to, in imaging, one of the biggest problem is the signal is so low, and that you need several frames to be averaged to be able to make a picture which is of any particular significance. In fact, many a times when we are looking at each other, the scattering photons that are actually entering our eye is very, very low. The only reason we can see each other is because our brain chips are smart enough to be able to average so many shots at such a speed that we are able to see. And if you go back to the visionary principles and study about vision, you will understand that these timescales where the first triggering of the event happens within 6 femtoseconds. That was shown by one of these laser studies. And so that's one of the reasons to say why we are able to be so efficient in figuring out images and other things. So here also you need to actually frame average many, many shots to be able to see it. And so to do a coherent control or do these kinds of studies on this kind of a principle is very difficult, because you need to have pulses which will actually be able to give you these kinds of control. So here what we have done is we have actually produced double pulses. Instead of having one pulse, we have now produced two pulses which are controllably separable to each other. And by using that, we were able to show how the interference of these pulses gave rise to the different fluorophores being selectively looked at and imaged. And here is actually the picture. It came out pretty well. So some of these fluorophores were looking at as one way under certain delay between the two pulses, and as we delayed it further, then these certain fluorophores were visible on this side are now no longer visible. And so you can actually do a very nice study. This was this has just now come out. Okay. There is another thing which we are also doing, which is kind of interesting. It also has again some relevance to the way we want to do it, is that it can be turned around into biology, but it can also have some consequences in these areas of computing. Many a time we know a discontinuity when we are there. Okay. And there has been a lot of work on this. These are known as one-way functions. The point is, if you are sitting at a discontinuity, in this case, particular case, we are actually showing an interface as a discontinuity. And in this interface, we have chosen two different solvents. One is immiscible with the other, and one of them has the dye and the other one doesn't have the dye, although it can be the other way around. But the dye is miscible in both the cases. So, the point is, when you do traditional spectroscopy, in fact, one of the best ways of measuring this and doing this is known as second harmonic generation. What you do is you focus the light in here, and if the light is intense enough, because it's a discontinuity, it actually you can show that the third order nonlinearity doesn't vanish, and you can actually collect light which shows that this is the discontinuity. But that is possible only when you are there. How will you know that you have a discontinuity coming up when you are not really there? This is the question that we address, and it turned out that when we were putting in one laser pulse and then looking at it with another laser pulse, the time scales that we measured changed as we approached the interface. And this is one of the very first instances which shows that you can probe an interface from a remote point. So, this is like remote sensing an interface, which turns out to be a very important technique, because this is one of the very few ways. What it essentially is measuring is a transport. Because in these cases what is happening is these are the dyes that we had used. This is how actually it looks as you are approaching from the bulk to the interface, it shoots up. And actually you can go through, you can choose some solvents where you will see the effect of the interface exactly, where in both the cases, suppose there are dyes, those are interfaces which have that kind of a situation, then you can show and you can see those two different cases. This is generally the principle here. What happens is that you have different layers. This is known as dichloromethane, this is water anyway. And this is a dye which I have cartooned it as a water loving end versus a water non loving end, and because it has a water loving end, it wants to go there, and so you have a transport. And once you have a transport, what you are actually measuring, what I showed, was the transport mechanism. The lifetime was changing because of this transport mechanism, and so now we can measure that an interface is coming by just measuring the transport process. So, that turns out to be a very interesting technique. And so, finally, I have this slide which shows you the plethora of the stuff that we are trying out in our lab. Everything is almost all based on this principle that we can actually modulate the light pulses as we want through our through our Fourier transform technique. Light, as I said, allows you to make itself into Fourier transform by putting it through a. So, here what we do is we use a grating and a mirror, but curved mirror. Basically, grating lens combination puts into a Fourier domain, and the Fourier domain, the time is not an issue. You can spatially modulate it whatever way you want, and we use an acousto-optic modulator which can be controlled by an arbitrary waveform generator, and based on that you can write the information that you would like. This also works very nicely for optical communication. And all these DWDM principles, which is dense code modulation methods, are based on this principle. And you come out and you get the pulse output, and you can have very nice delays with respect to each other, as well as you can produce all kinds of modulated pulses. And with these you can do many other things. We have shown you, I have given you some glimpses of studies. What we are actually after is we would like to put multiple pulses in such a way so that we can attain whatever the NMR people have achieved, which is the two-dimensional spectroscopy, where they have managed to show that they can measure very reliably the time scales of different species, how the decoherence happens and things like that. You can pick that up, and if you can get there, then who knows, you know, you might be replacing part of MRI studies by these kinds of things also, because that's the principle which is used in MRI. The advantage of the all optical scheme is the fact that people with pacemakers can be made available to these kinds of techniques, because somebody who has a pacemaker cannot be put into an MRI, he will freeze to death. Anyway, so those are the principles that we are after. So we keep the funding agencies happy and they keep us happy by letting us do quantum computing also. And technology involved are quite a few. This is a fiber based laser. This is a large frame amplified laser system which is used for many different repetition rates and different wavelengths and things that we use. This is the microscopy part where we have commercial microscope as well as home built microscope. To make sure that this looks home built all the time, we have put a torch light on the top, a flashlight. And these are our polyshapers and this is our beam chamber. So with these, I definitely have to thank the strong group of students. As I said, this was one of my reasons to move into IIT 5 years ago, more than 5 years now. And the student base has really helped us getting into whatever we are today. And I'm very happy that, you know, this guy is now in UC Irvine, this guy is going to Stanford, this fellow is soon going to go to Cornell, and so other, let's not discuss that, those things. We hope that they will again come back and serve whatever we are trying them to do. And with that, I would like to thank you.
Any questions, sir?
With regard to this lifetimes at the interface with the dye and water, suppose, did you see the lifetime changing, I mean, without any water?
No, it didn't change.
It didn't change, because most of the time, you know, like when you have, as you go to the excitations to the surface, normally self-absorption actually quenches the lifetime. Actually, you see a sharp reduction in the lifetime. It's a well-known process, because self-absorption actually leads to the fall in the lifetime. I mean, is it that, you know, self-absorption probably, you know, when you go to the interface layer, because water anyway does not absorb, does it lead to, without water also probably you may see the change in the lifetimes?
Yeah, we did those experiments, it didn't change. Also, we did these experiments under various different concentrations. And so, at the lowest possible concentrations also these results are well preserved. That was actually one of the questions we had to answer. Yeah.
You mentioned that you also have been able to do two molecules talking to each other in experiments. I mean, a single gas phase you showed. Also, as you mentioned, you have done something on more than one.
I don't have that graph here. What we have managed to do is when this was in, this is in connection with the optical trapping, optical tweezers. One of the problems which we always had when we went down in size is that this was a major problem which he was also mentioning, is that there is a lot of aggregation. So we had to go to a point where we could, in fact, play around with the buffer conditions and everything in such a way, so these particles in fact were repelling each other. And under that condition, it's very interesting, because if you can make them repel each other, then you will be in a condition where you can see a single particle very easily. Once it is trapped, now it's the interesting part is the trapping might be strong enough, it's a local perturbation to a point to strong enough that it can now attract, even though it was otherwise getting, repelled, now we can attract the second particle and come in. But they are repelling particles. I mean, naturally they don't want to stick together. Okay, so what happens is after a while it will come out, and you can see these as steps.